So as I told you, the technique of choice would be a safe, simple, whatever it is, it should be safe. You should take a simple technique. Don't go for complicated techniques. Just choose techniques in which you are very, very comfortable and familiar, reliable, and robust. So familiar, reliable, and robust. That is also very important. Familiar, reliable, and robust. So take certain techniques which are very, very familiar to you, and they should be reliable. You should be able to do it at the first attempt maximum times. So, and it should be very, very robust. That is also very important. That is very, very crucial. So these things will help you a lot. So the technique of choice will also decide to how well you're going to go ahead and go and intubate these kind of patients. Okay, now coming to the next slide. This is the circuit setup. As I told you, you can see there is a face mask, there is a viral filter, and on top of that you can see there is a bag-valve ventilation. Okay, that is how you have to use it. Now coming to intubating technique, rapid sequence induction is preferred. So again, I'm telling you, rapid sequence induction is preferred. Meticulous pre-oxygenation is needed. At least 3 to 5 minutes of meticulous pre-oxygenation is needed. And please avoid HFNC and NIV. Please avoid HFNC and NIV. Sometimes they generate a lot of aerosols, so they are dangerous. And as I told you, a HME filter between circuit and catheter mount, patient positioning. So what I want you to understand, what I mean by the term avoid HFNC and NIV is, previously when we are intubating some patients in some ICUs, etc., when a patient is on NIV, what they do, they will give the induction drug, paralytics, patient will still be on the NIV, then once patient is paralyzed, they'll just go in and then take the scope and intubate. Now, that is not advisable in COVID-19 because these can generate aerosol. So when the patient is on a HFNC and NIV, there is no point in you standing in the room at that time. So a face mask technique will give you a better seal. I'll tell you how to go about. At the same time, HFNC has been used to treat COVID-19 hypoxemia. That is a different story. But when you're about to intubate, it is better to remove all HFNC and NIV if the patient is already beyond. You just use a good bag mask ventilation with a good seal. Don't ventilate. Just put a good seal, pre-oxygenate, and then slowly go about. Okay, I'll tell you how to go. So this is the hand grip which you should choose. A BE hand grip, a two-hand hand grip. So as you know, previously we used to have the CE hand grip. Now, with this method, we are going to use a two hands vice grip. So can you see the two hand VE hand grip? So this will create a better seal. This will take a better seal. So that is also very, very, very important. One second. So this will also create a very good seal. So the most important thing, the important change that they have given is they have started a BE hand grip. Okay. So from a CE hand grip, it is going to be a BE hand grip. Okay. I think some more clarity with this picture. Okay. Now coming to induction and paralytics, you have pre-oxygenated, everything is ready. Your equipment is in place. Team is ready. Fluids are ready, inotropes on standby. What agents do I choose? See, some of them do have hemodynamic instability post-intubation, so you can use ketamine. Propofol can also be used. Propofol causes some element of vasodilatation as well as hypotension. Ketamine is good even in shock anesthesia, so the chance of it causing hypotension is less. Fentanyl as an opioid you can use. And when it comes to intubating, you need a paralytic agent which will give you ideal intubating conditions within a few minutes. That is what you want. So there is no point in using Vicronium, etc., which in which you have to ventilate for a huge amount of time. So what you're going to use is rockronium 1.2 milligram per kilogram or succinylcholine 1.5 milligram per kilogram. They will give you ideal intubating conditions in 120 seconds and 90 seconds respectively. Okay, so now succinylcholine is a drug which I don't know how many of you have used. We used to use in our anesthesia times a decade ago. Still this drug is there. But the most beautiful thing about this drug is it will produce paralysis within 90 seconds. You will have ideal intubating conditions. But because of some side effects, colon apnea, bradycardia, etc., slowly they stop using this particular paralytic agent. And this particular paralytic agent was not used. Okay, it was not used, it was taken away. It can sometimes cause a rise in ICP and all. So they went for the paralytic agents like Vecronium. But now this particular paralytic agent is now coming back into the picture. It is now coming back into the picture. So this is a beautiful drug to have in your ICU. Be very careful. The vial is very similar to midazolam. So the color also are very similar to each other. So be very careful when you're using this drug. It is usually 1.5 milligram per kilogram will be the dose. Okay. As I told you, fluids and inotropes have to be on standby. And a video laryngoscope with a separate screen will be the ideal way to go about. Suppose you are comfortable with a video laryngoscope, it is better you go for a video laryngoscope and that too with a separate screen. So now this clearly tells you how a COVID-19 intubation should be done. The main intubator completely in PPE. The person who is assisting him is wearing a PPE. And here also another patient is there who is wearing a PPE. Sorry, another person is there to help the staff nurse that is also wearing a PPE. You can see he is wearing a helmet visor, he is wearing a N95 mask, goggles, everything is in place. So this is how you should go ahead. This much preparation is needed. And as you can see, he is using a video laryngoscope and he is able to see the vocal cords through a separate screen. So if you have a separate screen, you need not bend down closer to the mouth and look at the screen. If there is a separate screen away, you can look at the screen and then slowly introduce the tube. So the distance between the mouth and your face is at a higher distance. So this will reduce the incidence of aerosol generation at reaching your face. That's what I want you to understand. So these are extra precautions which you can take. You may ask, sir, what do I do if I am not comfortable with the video laryngoscope or if I don't have a video laryngoscope with a separate screen? Don't worry. You have paralyzed the patient. So now the patient is not in a position to cough. You go ahead, if you're having you're using a regular Macintosh laryngoscope, you use that and you go ahead and intubate as quick as possible. So that's what. So the ideal thing in COVID-19 would be to have a video laryngoscope. But if you don't have a video laryngoscope, you can very well use your regular intubating techniques to achieve intubation and pass the endotracheal tube. So I need not tell you, but you all of you will be Googling. So as you Google, you will be able to see that there are so many techniques that many people have perfected. There are a lot of ways. There have been this intubation hood is very, very famous nowadays. Many people bought it, anywhere they bought it. But unfortunately, once we also tried, when we put our hands inside and we manipulate, it is sometimes difficult. It is not so easy. So in theater intubations, this might be helpful. So there'll be ideal conditions. Conditions will be much more ideal than in an ICU setup. So in theater intubations, definitely this might be more useful. Okay. But intubating hoods are going to stay for a longer period. I think there'll be more modifications produced in that, so that will make us more safe. But most important thing is your face should be protected. So that is very, very important. Prevent the aerosol from reaching your face. Okay. Now, as I told you, the moment you intubate, what you have to understand is there is no role for a stethoscope. There is no point in you going using a stethoscope and checking whether there is bilateral air entry. Please don't proceed towards that. So auscultation of the chest is difficult. It is not done at all. You cannot auscultate also. You'll be completely covered. Your hood will be there. There is no scope, no stethoscope inside the COVID ward itself. First point. Second point, if you want to find out whether air entry is equal or not, you have to wait for a chest x-ray or a lung ultrasound. These are the two mechanisms by which you can see whether you have intubated correctly and probably there is bilateral air entry. And all the tracheal tubes better attach a subglottic suction port along with it. For some people, this might be a little bit higher. Just understand that some endotracheal tubes have a small suction attached to the subglottic area. This will prevent the pooling of secretions in the subglottic area. Why I'm doing this is to prevent the incidence of ventilator-associated pneumonia. Okay, so if you have that, please use it. So this is an emergency tracheal intubation checklist. And you can see the personal protective equipment, preparing the equipment, preparing for difficulty, and what and all you should be doing.